"Hey, what's up?" Those were his first words to me as we walked into a center located in the southwest corner of the country. He extended his hand to me, gave me some dap, said, "Dude, I like your hair." I said, "Thanks, man. I like your hair too." We talked a bit before we turned on the recorder, just exchanging cordials, saying whatever was on his mind. Then we hit record. This young man, his name is Carl, he starts to tell us about his experience with school, his education track, his family, his friends, the people that he knew. And he started off by saying that, you know, when I was younger, you know, my parents were from Mexico, and they didn't quite understand the education system here. So I'd go home, my mom would be like, "Hey, what'd you get, a 1, 2, 3? And he's like, "Mom, it doesn't work that way. It's such a different system." But she tried to help him. Some things happened in his life. His dad got arrested, was deported, sent back to Mexico. And his mom had a little bit of resentment towards his dad. And whenever she looked at him, she saw his dad. Life was a little bit tough at home for him. By age 11, he was homeless, on his own, living with different relatives here and there, sofa surfing. Didn't consider himself homeless, but he was essentially homeless by the time he was 11 years old. Family members took him in. Some of them, to some degree, helped him along the way. Some of them, to some degree, weren't so helpful. So here he was, 15 years old, out skateboarding one night, banged his head, and woke up in cuffs. The police officers said that he was intoxicated, unruly, and they arrested him. Now, at this point in his life, he had connected with a school, and the school was a part of this huge network where they provided housing, they provided health care. There was a campus nearby for actual school and education purposes. But he knew at that moment that he didn't have many people out there. He had that one connection. So he called his friend, because he couldn't remember the name. He called a friend and said, "Hey, you got to call Lisa down at the program. Let her know I'm in jail." And Lisa corralled all the resources she could, raised about $500, and got him out of jail. He ran from the detention facility, the jail, straight to the school to thank Lisa. And in thanking Lisa, he saw the people behind Lisa, and he said, "Oh, thank you all for being there for me. I don't know what I would do if you weren't here for me. I'd probably still be sitting in jail." Now, Carl was a young man who was very, very grateful for every single breath that he took in life. And he was ultimately really grateful for anything that anybody had ever done for him, because he learned early on that nobody's got to do anything for you in this world. And that was a lesson that he learned from his mom. And so what Lisa did was she said, "Okay, listen, you got to go to school. Here's some conditions. You got to go to school." And he's like, "Yeah, but I need a place to live." She's like, "All right, we got that. We got a program right here. Here are the two people that are going to introduce you to your new home." They took him to Walmart or someplace, got him towels, soap, toothbrush, toothpaste, some underwear, socks, jeans, shirts, book bag, notebooks, pencils, paper, things that he needed. Then he said, "Wow, I can't give up on these people. These people haven't given up on me." And then he got some legal advice and all types of counseling and support. And to this day, this guy is still striving in a school that he feels like he's found his home, his tribe, so to speak. Shortly after that, we get on the plane, fly over to the middle of the country, Denver, where we met Kay. I'm just going to call her Kay for right now. And Kay started off by telling us, I mean, she was a bubbly, energetic, loving life type of young person. She starts off by saying, "Like, I don't remember anything before I was 10 years old." Clearly, something traumatic under there, right? And so she gets into her story. She's like, yeah, so, you know, like around 6th or 7th grade, I was in this program. It was a very structured program. 8 o'clock, I woke up. 8:02, I was brushing my teeth. 8:05, I was here. 8:10, I was there. It was a very structured day, minute by minute, and I needed that. A few years down the road, she's about to get into high school, and her parents, her dad actually gave her the choice. He said, hey, you can come live with us in the car, or you can go into a shelter. So she goes into a shelter. And in the shelter, there were people there that she said that, you know, they kind of bugged me at first. Like, I didn't quite get it. Why they were, like, at me. Why they kept talking to me. Why were they so interested in me? And then we later found out that, you know, she finally left that program, went to high school. And it was funny as she was telling us about the relationships with the people that she had in high school. She's like, yeah, you know, well, first it was Joyce. Oh, Joyce. She was the reason I kept going to school every day. Like, I would go to school, but I was literally just hanging out. Like, I didn't go to any classes. Teachers were always throwing me out. But I knew that Joyce would be there. And Joyce was counting on me to be there. So, and then she's like, yeah, there's another one. Travis. Travis was a security guy, too. Right? And then there was Mr. So-and-so. He was a disciplinarian. She's like, oh, my God. All the people in my life are there because I kept getting in trouble. But these are the people that relied on me to come to school, and I relied on them being there, right? And I love Kay's definition of a GED. She said, most people see a GED, and they think, oh, this kid's a mess up, and She said, I see a GED, and I see this kid went through some stuff. There was something that happened here. So when you see Mike, and Mike's wearing the same thing for the entire week, you should probably pull Mike aside at some point and say, hey, Mike, I just noticed this. Is there any way that I could help? Now, Kay wants to go on and become a teacher, which I'm just like, my heart almost jumped out, like, yay! You know, we need more teachers, more caring teachers. And that's not to say that teachers don't care. All right, just to be clear. but, you know, she had this angle, and she's like, you know what? Because I've been through so much in my life, like, something happened early on. She was in detention centers. She was in a shelter. She's like, I can relate to these kids. And more people like me should probably step up and try to help. She also is the mother of a young child. She said that she didn't want that life for her kid. So that's why she works so hard on getting her GED so that she can be a model for her kid. And last but not least, this wasn't the end of our journey, but I feel like I always have to share this story because to me, it broke me down. Now, for those of you that don't know, my name is Craig McClay. I'm a research assistant at the Center for Promise and the Youth Engagement Advisor at America's Promise. And when we go out into the field to collect data, we do this group interview format. It's a very interactive methodology. We build trust. Young people hear their voice. They connect with each other. There's a whole, like, just science behind how this works, right? And so here we were in Portland doing the group interview. We got through all the ice-breaking stuff. Everybody in the room was feeling comfortable. They're all like, yeah. And it's like, okay, now, let's hear your stories. And, you know, there's a brief moment of, like, oh, boy, I don't know. And then Amanda said, ah, what the hell? I'll share my story. She started off by saying, well, I was a prostitute for about 5 years. And there was just nothing out there for me. You know, when I was younger, I grew up, I pretty much raised myself. By fifth grade, I wasn't going to school. And because I was bigger, I had a name that sounded kind of mannish. People teased me a lot. And I just didn't like that. And I didn't have anything at home, so I needed to get out and get money. So I turned to prostitution. And one night, my pimp slash boyfriend sent me to work, and she vividly gave us a description, and I won't remember it. I mean, I won't forget it. In that, she said, it was cold, it was rainy, I hardly had anything on. And I said, this can't be. This is not my life. I don't want this anymore. So she did a beeline straight to some local police officers that kind of hung out in the area, patrolled the area. And she's like, yo, take me home. And they were just like, yeah, okay, whatever, man. Like, you know, listen, just stay out of trouble. We don't believe you, so forth and so on. She's like, no, I really want to go home. So some back and forth after a couple of hours, The police officer said, okay, we're going to take you down to the station. They took her down to the station, got her enrolled in the program that shipped her further down the coast out of state. But she's like, as soon as I got there, I just felt like a fish out of water. I knew nobody. I had no connections. I had nothing. So I got back on the bus and went back to home. Oh, I'm terribly sorry. Okay. So I got back on the bus and went back home. And when I got back home, I remember one of the people that the police officers had given me a card, had given me their card. And she said to me, you know, like one thing that made it really, really possible for her to connect is a police officer essentially removed his hat as a police officer and became a person to her. It was no longer this authority and I'm to be chastised, whatever. It's a person-to-person connection here now. So he gave her a card and she connected with this program. It was actually a high school GED program where you can get credit for college as well. And she said, you know what? I wasn't really interested in that because, you know, you're telling me I need an education. That's true. But right now I need a place to live. I need money. I need food. I need shelter. I need basic things. And she said the people at the program understood it. They got it. So when I connected with that person then kind of activated this web around me. You know, there was actually, just like the first story I shared with you, there's this campus where there's a school, there's healthcare, there's counselors, there's everything you need. It's very convenient, right? And it took, and she said this too, she said it took about four or five people to support all of my needs because I came in needing a lot. And one other thing about this program is that the people that ran the program, the adults, were like me. They had been on the street. They knew what life on the street was like. They knew that I needed all types of support, and I needed it from multiple people. And I needed it intensely. Because I would go into job interviews, and it's like, hey, yeah, I've been a prostitute for 5 years. It's like, that doesn't fly. You know? And she kind of choked up. She's like, I went back after I got hired at Jack in the Box. And I went back and shared that experience with the people that coached me on how to actually interview to get a job. And she was crying, bawling, because she didn't have the skill sets to have a decent conversation with someone, much less how to get a job and go about comporting yourself in that type of situation. Amanda I think she was 23 or 24 when we met her, and she was really concerned because she's like, now I'm about to age out of this program, and I don't know what to do. Where am I gonna go? So I was just like, get a job at that center. <You know? laughs> That way you never have to leave. These are just some samples of some of the over, 100 stories that we heard. And my wish is that, I wish that no one had to go through these things, first of all, right? But secondly, I wish that everyone in here and everyone in the world could have been in those rooms while we conducted those interviews, because those young people shared a side of themselves that I don't think that most of the world gets to see. I think what we get to see is a caricature of the young person who disengages, which is sitting at home, playing PlayStation, smoking, drinking, whatever, right? But these young people were saying to us, no, that's not my life. That's not what I want for myself. I want a whole lot more. I just need support. And I think that, you know, you reading that, that's one thing. You hearing about it, that's another thing. But you walking their walk with them is where we all need to be. So at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Zaff here, who will explain a lot better than I did what we're doing here.
No, not in the least. Thank you. So good morning, everyone. I hope you take away from Craig and you'll start to really remember, not only hopefully remember forever these stories that Craig has told, but really reflect on them as we go through the research that we conducted together over the past year. About a year or so ago, we, as America's Promise, were continually championing, we continue to champion, in fact, just last week, we're championing the fact that the graduation rate in this country keeps on going up, right? We're still, hopefully we'll get on track to be at 90%. We're just about there, right? We're more than 82% right now on an upward trajectory, and it's a lot to celebrate. And we should be very proud as a country that we've done a lot for a lot of young people. However, we also recognized was that nearly 500,000 young people, so many of whom are expressing the stories that Craig just told, leave school every year, every single year, and that nobody's listening to them. And so we did this first report, Don't Call Them Dropouts, really based on this idea that we have to start to listen. We have to start to hear what these young people are going through and understand them in an authentic way. And we called it Don't Call Them Dropouts because, in fact, when Craig would go in, and he's usually very humble, and he's this time humble again about how he's able to engage with the youth in these sessions, it really is a magical experience where they, again, as you heard, express the most intimate details of their lives. But the very first thing was, so y'all are dropouts, right? So we just want to make sure you're the right people to talk to for this study we're doing on dropouts in America, right? Makes sense. They said, well, wait a second. We left school, but we didn't drop out. Because dropout connotes something very negative. It connotes weakness. It connotes disengagement, disaffection, et cetera. That's not what these young people were about. Really what we heard was a story of hope and strength. And that these were young people who were hit by all sides with adversity, the kinds that you just heard about. But they got back up again time and time again, this amazing resiliency. And they searched for connection. And when they found that connection, they reached up and began to thrive. Now, it's a central piece of connection which hit us time and again. And that really led us to this next step to say, okay, now we have an understanding about who they are a little more authentically, realistically. But now we want to understand how can we help. It's enough to know we can diagnose the problem all day long, and we all know that we try every day to help young people in these situations, but what is it that's really going to help them? And we believe that these ideas are really about the relationships that they have in their lives. So to figure that out, we're researchers. We're at the Center for Promise, which is the Research Institute for America's Promise. We went right to the source. This is the kind of work we do. The work we do as a Center for Promise is we take a youth-centered approach, right? We don't impose. We don't say, well, we think we know what's going on with you, so we're just going to ask the things that we believe are going on. We want to know from your eyes, from your lens, from your voice, what's going on in your life, so we can better understand it. So we do this in two different ways. We do this through qualitative interviews, as Craig described. As you can see in the slide for young people all over the country, Craig and our colleague Melissa Maharaj stacked a plane tickets, took off, right? Went to all these different cities, eight cities. We actually went to a bunch more cities, but included in this study were eight cities, 16 groups, a bunch of additional individual interviews to really get at their most intimate details about their lives. We then went more broad with a survey. This is the quantitative side. We surveyed in a national survey nearly 3,000 young people, just fewer than half of whom had left school before graduating, right? And we put that all together, and here's what we got. So I want to just mention the four findings quickly, and I'm going to go back to each one in more depth. So number one, these are young people who experienced way too many hurdles coupled with too few supports, right? High hurdles, few supports. Number two is when you actually get those supports, it really matters. And it can matter a lot. So it's one thing to say you need supports, another thing to say they matter, right? Number three is that these supports matter so much they can actually buffer the kinds of risks we're talking about here, the kinds of adversities we're talking about, but to a point. And I'll talk about that point in a few minutes. And finally, when we talk about what's then needed, about these relationships, it was about this thing, and Craig alluded to it on this web of support, right? That it's no one person, a young person's life who's going to do it all, but it's a constellation of supports, an ecology of caring, in a sense, that's really going to propel young people to that next level in their lives. So now to get back to each one of these. So too many hurdles, too little help. So again, reflect back on the stories that Craig just told you. And think about the things that they experienced, many of which are expressed in this slide. Homelessness, experience with the foster care system, experiencing abuse, emotional and physical abuse, becoming a teen parent, becoming an adult way before you should be an adult. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. Parents incarcerated on drugs, gang involvement, etc. So when we asked young people through our survey, how many of these did you experience? Well, number one is we heard that those who leave school experience twice as many adverse life experiences as those who stay in school without interruption, averaging 5. Put another way, 52% of our sample experienced 5 or more adverse life experiences. So just think about that again. So take one of those and imagine if you experienced that. And what, how you think you might react? Well, you might get knocked down pretty hard and you might not get back up. Now tack on 4 more. Take your choice, there's a long list. And now think again how you would bounce back from that. And this is the experience, again, of 52% of our sample, of those who leave school. Right. So way too high hurdles. Now, that's coupled with not enough support. So we looked at support in 2 ways. We looked at it, we asked young people about the source of that support, family, somebody in school, your friends, an adult in your community. We also asked about the type of support. So we know caring matters, and that's emotional support. Do I matter to somebody? Does somebody care about me? Does somebody love me? Foundational, unbelievably important. Can't do without it, but it's not enough, right? We also need instrumental support, the kind of thing of, well, I need stuff. I need a roof over my head. I need food on my table. I need a ride to school. I need a tutor, instrumental support. I need to know how to do stuff. How do I navigate this complex world around me called life? That's informational support. And finally, are people setting expectations for me and actually holding me accountable to meet those expectations? Appraisal support. So again, 4 sources and 4 types. So across all 4 sources and all 4 types, those who leave school experience statistically significantly less support than those who stay in school. So again, highest hurdles you can possibly imagine with this idea potentially of this poverty of relationships that they're experiencing. Right? So does it matter though about those relationships? I don't think we'd all be attending the National Mentoring Summit if we didn't think relationships matter. It might be the economic forum that's just down the hallway. So do they matter? Yes, we all know. In our gut, we know. We know we're human beings, we're social animals. Relationships matter. And in some ways, they're the only thing that matters when it really comes down to it. So we want to know, well, how do they matter around things like graduation? So in our analysis, what we find is, if you look here, the source matters and the type matters. So it's not just about one kind of person doing one type of thing for you. So you see that just overall support from adults in school reduces the likelihood you'll leave school by 25%, right? Instrumental support from parents or from those in school reduces it by 20%, right? Emotional support by as much. But it's also your friends. They matter too. Because anybody work with adolescents? Show of hands. Anybody have adolescents? Do they listen to you? Do they listen to their friends? Yes, right? So if you need help, who do you turn to? You turn to your friends. And we heard time and again from the interviews was that when the young people needed something, and they said, well, where do I go to do this? They asked their friends. And that's how they got reconnected oftentimes to these great engagement centers that we went to. But also other adults and communities matter, right? So every source matters and every type matters, but they matter in different ways from different people, right? So again, source and type, it matters. Now here's another piece I really want to focus on for a second, this idea of strength. So there's this idea, this is marshmallow. So if I can just resist the marshmallow, research seems to tell me that I'm going to be a hedge fund billionaire if I just resist the marshmallow for a few minutes, right? This seems to be, there's this narrative on self-control, right? That this is like, oh, well, it must mean that if I'm gritty enough, right? If I can just resist temptation enough, then I succeed in life. Well, let's take that to its logical conclusion. So for those who succeed, they must have these things like grit, self-control, etc. So for those who aren't so-called succeeding, what does that mean? Oh, I guess that means they don't have it. Well, we come from this perspective. That's not true. I'm guessing most of you come from that perspective too. And you hear from the stories, these are the grittiest young people you'll ever meet, right? They got a lot of self-control to get through life every day. Navigational abilities that are, you know, beyond compare. Really amazing strength. As a separate study we did based on our Don't Call Them Dropout work, we actually mapped, we analyzed the strengths of these young people compared to the CASEL framework for socio-emotional learning competencies, which many of you might be familiar with. These are the things that are supposed to really matter for success in school. And these were all young people who had left school. Every single one of them expressed all of these, more or less all of these competencies. But if you don't have a home, if you're on your own, if you're a prostitute, probably being abused by your pimp, does school really matter to you all that much? That's probably not your goal. So to direct your strength toward that goal doesn't really matter all that much. Does it mean that you don't have strength? Definitely not. So now let's look at it from this perspective. We asked in our survey about self-control. Self-report, but it was things like, you know, basically like temptation-like questions, like if you want to stay on task, can you stay on task without getting having your attention diverted, things like that. It's been a measure used a lot with a lot of different populations. We're pretty confident about it. So what we find is that those with high self-control compared to those with low self-control, but when they both have low levels of social support, there's no difference in the likelihood they graduate without interruption. Right, so think about that again. High self-control, I resisted marshmallows on my road to a hedge fund billionaire. Low self-control, but both have less, not very much social support in their lives. No difference in that academic outcome. Now, when you introduce social support into the mix, now you got high social support, that's where you start to see a gap. If you have high self-control and high social support, it enables you to direct your strengths toward these things like academic goals. So does strength matter? Well, yeah, it matters. And you hear it clearly in the stories Craig told you. But when does it matter for things like outcomes we'd love for all of our young people in America, like education? It matters when you have the kinds of social support that can help direct it to these positive outcomes. So relationships matter. Now this third point, that relationships can buffer. So when we looked at young people and we grouped a bunch of social supports together, so from, again, these four sources across these four types. And then we wanted to see, well, if you got a bunch of these relationships, what does it look like if you have a bunch of adversity? So we looked at those with a little bit of adversity, 0 to 1 of those on that list, 2 to 4, and 5+. So for those 0 to 1, they're breezing through life. They're on a 12-lane superhighway toward education without any other cars on the road and huge bumpers on the side, right? They can swerve, they can be drunk. They're gonna graduate from high school okay. And we see this in a lot of communities in this country. Right, literally, driving drunk, but still graduating and doing well in life, right? So when we look at 2 to 4 it levels up pieces of adversity in their life, experiences, again, that's pretty severe, if we think about that, right? 2 to 4 experiences of those things, homelessness, foster care, abuse, drug use, gang violence, et cetera. There's this pretty substantial buffering effect of having these pretty much everyday relationships in your life. Somebody I can turn to for help, somebody can help me find a tutor, somebody, if I have a problem, that's who I turn to, right? Can substantially buffer the negative effect of that level of adversity in your life. Just having a group of people you can turn to in times of need. However, once you hit that 5+ level, again, 52% of our sample hit that level, you go over an adversity cliff. That kind of support's not going to be enough. Now, does that mean support doesn't matter anymore? Not at all. In fact, as Craig, I think you mentioned, the intensity is what needs to be ratcheted up. That's what's needed. And so we heard in our interviews, as you heard in the stories, but as we heard across all of our interviews, what young people need in those situations is to be able to deal with the trauma they're experiencing. They need to understand how to navigate human services. They need to know how to just do things for their for a family they may have now. That's more than just having somebody to turn to for help. You need somebody who, mental health professionals, you need somebody who's there for you 24/7, et cetera. A more professionalized group of people, probably complemented by people who are just there, who are your rock. So relationships matter, but the intensity needs to be much higher. So again, super high hurdles, not enough support. When they get support, it really matters, and it can buffer substantially. But what does that look like, right? So what we found in our work is this idea of an anchor and a web. So the anchor helps to stabilize. It's somebody a young person needs that they trust. Oftentimes, if not, you know, whether it has to be in addition to a family member or it can include the family member, you know, we're still working through that. But at the very least, you need that somebody, a formal mentor, a natural mentor, somebody who you know is going to be there when you call. And they can help stabilize, they can help, you know, connect you a little bit. But what we also find is it's not enough. When we hear from, basically across every single narrative we heard from young people, there was not one that said it was only because of this person. Yes, it was because of that person, but it was also because of all these other people, right? It's because I needed help with my math homework, and this person was this great tutor who not only tutored me, but actually helped me aspire to bigger things. I needed, again, food on the table, so this other person knew how to get me involved with SNAP, right? I actually had mental health issues because of all the trauma I was facing. This person helped me there. And then I had the group of other people who were my friends, who were just my rocks and gave me that support. So when we think about what the call to arms becomes, it becomes more than saying every person needs to do everything for a young person. But it shows that everybody has a role to play and that everyone can be someone, so that everyone can play a role. Everyone can be the math teacher who might have 30 students in their class and is already overwhelmed, so this is not to pile on teachers. But if that teacher recognizes that there's a student who has the same clothes on one day they were in the day before, check in, right? It shows, one, you care, emotional support, and you could maybe even say, why don't you go down the hall? I'll even walk you down the hallway to Miss Jones, the counselor, and she can do more for you, right? So I'm not the all-in person. I don't need to be, but I've done something. I'm the person in the neighborhood who sits on the stoop when the kids come home from school just to say hi, just to make sure that I care. They know I care about them, right? You're not doing everything, but you're doing something. So it's a much different call to arms for us, a mobilizing call than the individual. So again, we think about too many hurdles and too little help. That help actually matters, and it matters a lot. It buffers the negative effects of adversity, but to a point, this idea of an adversity cliff. But that doesn't mean they don't matter. It just means you gotta ratchet up the intensity. And when we're thinking about mobilizing and designing programs, how do we facilitate this creation of webs? Or probably more realistically, as young people are already embedded in webs of supports or relationships, and how do we strengthen them? How do we refine them so they provide them with the kinds of supports that will let them unleash the strengths we know they have? So with that, I'll turn it back to Craig, because we'd love to have a discussion about this point of what can we then do.
So at this point, does anybody have any questions? Here. Yeah, I think it is.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Is the research ongoing, or are you done with this project?
So we're done with this particular piece. We're still doing additional analyses on this. We are doing a couple of follow-up studies, though. One is looking at how do you actually create connection? So, you know, not everybody is a Craig who can come in and connect so intimately. And we can't rely just on having Craigs in the world. So how do you actually understand how to create better connection with young people? And then secondly is this web idea. We want to go much deeper on that because that really stuck out to us. And the third piece actually we're about to get into is more the adversity piece.
Differentiating between different adverse experiences saw that, but it seems like we're an ace is an ace is an ace, and I'm not sure that intuitively hits me as accurate.
Yeah, and that's something we're actually very interested in. It's part of our additional analyses. We want to understand that as well. So, I mean, just for everybody, you know, so you can look at it in two different ways, which is this list of, you know, basically an index. Just if you have five, it's worse than if you have two. But when you look at a lot of the list, you can see, well, you were physically abused. Is that worse than being homeless, or is it worse than being expelled from school? There might be different weightings. We do find in our analysis that there were set, we didn't put it in this presentation, we have in our full report, which is actually, it's website down below. You'll see we did have seven factors that seemed to rise to the top. We don't want to put all of our eggs in that basket, say that these are the seven most important by any means, but they seem to, at least for the outcome of education, seem to be really important.
Just a point of process, this is being streamed live, so there is a microphone in the audience, and I think that's the only way that the people on the web can actually hear what you're saying. So if we can just kind of pass the microphone around so that people can speak into it, that'd be great. Thank you.
Beyond the relationship, were there other types of protective factors?
So our focus, so one is, yes, there are a lot of other protective factors. We only looked at the role of relationships. For us, that not necessarily us, but we want others to do more of in research, which is to really look at other buffering effects, such as things like participation in different programs, et cetera, to really look at the role that relationships are playing within those kinds of activities, because sort of our hypothesis here is that everything is really on the shoulders of relationships, and we don't think that's too bold of a statement to make, but we just don't have enough research to go into that.
Thank you.
Hello, thank you. I just had two questions. One about, you know, the power of relationship and Craig's, and you can see it when people have that ability to connect with people very quickly, especially young people. But I mean, how, and I know not everyone has that, or maybe it's not innate, but certainly some coaching up around that would be helpful for people in this field. And so any thoughts you have about that? And then the other one is sort of, you know, I know that we're talking about students who have already disconnected from school, but in terms of looking upstream, how do we, you know, you want to hear from the youth, but there also has to be some form of assessment. You know, how do you sort that out, or how would you recommend that when people are trying to be more preventative in nature, like, because when they're gone, you know, they're going to need a lot. But before they go, how do we kind of strike that balance in hearing what we need to hear from them to provide them with what they need in a way that makes sense for them?
Yeah, I'll answer the second piece first, and I'll hand it to Craig, who'll do a much better job of answering the first. So, you know, what I'd say is one thing, and I think we recommend this in the report, actually, is that one is, you know, there's a bunch of needs assessments that are out there, right? And even you have early warning indicator systems, which I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with, as ways, you know, very much red flag ways to say there's something going on. And as Craig mentioned, like, the young people know this too, like, you got a GED, something was wrong, right? So these are indicators that are, you know, flags. And then it's what you do with those flags once you see them. So just because, you know, the early warning indicators are really powerful as holding up a flag, but they don't actually tell you anything about that young person for more than there's something going on, right? So the next step is to then go in and dig in and say, what is going on with this particular young person? And again, you can either do that from saying, okay, we need to increase our capacity with school counselors, with training teachers. There's some interesting initiatives around the country. One that I've just, which becoming a fan of, building assets reducing risks, BAR, which is came out of Minnesota, but it's now being scaled nationally, do that. They basically, you know, try to empower the entire faculty to sort of step in these ways. But then you can also do more of a broad-based assessment, you know, on risk factors, one. So there are school districts now doing the ACEs survey or some refinement of it, so the Adverse Childhood Experiences Survey across a student body, so they can understand that. Turnaround for Children in New York City is, you know, is a wonderful organization that tries to resolve issues of trauma in schools because they realize the level of trauma going on there and they need to resolve it. So there's a variety of ways to do. Community in schools would be another approach. So there's a variety of ways that you can actually go in and identify it. Some are more scalable than others. And so it's just, I think we have to work out the logistics of how do you do it. But I think the big piece here is it's not that hard to identify who's fallen off track early, you know, upstream. But it's how do you find out what's actually going on in their lives?
Yeah, and for the first part of the question there, I like the comment that was made from the stage yesterday. I forget the name of the gentleman who said it, but he's like, you got to eat what they eat, and, you know, walk where they walk, and, you know, breathe the air that they breathe. And express either, like, explicitly or implicitly, a genuine interest. Like, I'm really interested in what the story of your life is. Like, and there's no fake in that. Like, you just go in. And just one other thing that I could throw in there. I didn't do it here, at least to the degree that I normally do it. But I think one of the things that we can do a little bit better in terms of connecting with young people is start them up. Give them some unexpected thing. You know what I mean? Like, something unexpected, because that kind of opens you up. It's like somebody's like, I don't know, but it just kind of opens up your senses. Your eyes get wider, your ears actually open up, you know, your mouth stops for a second, you know, and you actually can absorb the information. So, you know, between like authentically showing I care, listening deeply, and that unexpected thing, and walking their walk, I think that's kind of like where it is. Kind of nuts and bolts, simple answer. But if you want to talk about it more, I'm way more to talk. I got volumes to speak about this. Okay, we can connect later on it. All right.
Thank you, guys, for bringing this relevant research, you know, and for, I think, helping folks understand that web that really affects young people's lives. Quickly, I was at the Corporation for Public Broadcasting when we created the American Graduate Initiative, right? And America's Problems is a big partner, and CPB functions sort of as a media partner around that. Quickly, could you guys speak to the relevance of using media as a tool to recruit young people, to bring them to the table, to, I think, get the stories that you guys' research is, you know, is using in a great way, and then also the side of cultural relevancy to these young people, right? Because the interveners, the people that step out there into that gap, they have to be able to connect with them, like you said, eat what they eat, breathe the air, and also speak the language. And oftentimes, great media can be a real good asset in terms of reaching them, because we know how media savvy our populations are.
So one, totally agree. And, you know, CPB has been a great partner on this kind of work. And I think for us, what we're trying to actually work through is, what are the best engagement techniques with young people themselves for them to actually be the ones who are really using the media in their ways? You know, so obviously social media is the way to do that. You know, I think obviously more traditional media also can be very powerful. And I think we need to understand, I think that's actually a step that needs to be taken, though, is more from, like, understand how young people are actually going to, what are they going to listen to, how are they going to listen to it, and create the messages that are going to be relevant to them. And, you know, and I think typically there aren't a lot of good, whether it's ad agencies, you know, public relations firms that actually go to young people themselves, or I should say, and this is why, if you can have Craig work on your team, well, you can't, because somebody like Craig. It's so important, because when we went into this work to begin with, it's going to sound like a tangent, but it gets to your point. What we're afraid of is that we're going to hear the same thing that we've seen in research time and again about young people. And we actually sat around the table and was like, oh my God, what if we just hear the same things? Like, we've invested all this time and money and whatever. And we said, we can't do that. But so therefore, we can't have kind of like a stale focus group. I don't know if y'all been in focus groups before. You've had M&Ms in the center of the table and a one-way mirror, right, or two-way mirror. So we knew that wasn't going to work, because these were young people, I mean, really all young people, and really I think no human being actually says what they really feel in these focus group settings. So that's a whole other story. But around young people especially, and especially about the young people we're talking about, so again, imagine hear the stories Craig talks about. To open up like that in that kind of setting with your peers is powerful. And with that, you can create the more authentic messages that are then going to resonate with young people themselves, which I think is the way we have to start to move in developing the media for these young people. Because, you know, and I know CPB has done a great job of actually capturing a lot of young people on video. And I think, you know, we'd love to talk about how do we actually get that out to more people, because, you know, it's an amazing resource. And again, that's what it's like, the voice of the young people themselves. So.
And I guess the only thing I would add to that is, I don't know if you were around for the session this morning, where the neighborhood safety guy was speaking, Devon. He's like, I went and hired the people that were the most offensive gun-toting people out there. So, I mean, my thing is engage young people around what they think is best for them. And, I mean, I say make it a job because a lot of people need money. And then support them in the structure and then watch the magic happen. Any other questions, comments? We got one right here. Here comes the mic.
I'd like to share a poem from a feminist from California named Natasha Josefowitz. It's called My Sister's Keeper, but it easily plays into My Brother's Keeper, and it can be a mantra, a touchstone, a motivation. It goes, I am my sister's keeper. I am my brother's keeper. We're all in this together, not to win, not to compete, not to conquer, but to educate, to nurture, to help. We are each other's keeper. Let us celebrate the power in us all to make a difference, to change the world.
Wow. That's beautiful. Thanks for sharing.
We're doing a lot of work with ACEs in Sonoma Valley, California as well, and just learning a lot about it. And one of the lines I thought that was so great that people are now saying, instead of children who are misbehaving or whatever, and we automatically say, what is wrong with you? Our new way of saying it is, what has happened to you? And I think that's a pretty powerful way to come about things.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. So I think I'm gonna do here first and then there.
I'm not sure what the rest of your time contains, so I want to say something because I'm really here in hopes to get some concrete questions answered that are emotional in nature for me, but also I want to reach out concretely for someone. I live about 5 hours away from a young person, a young man who's now 20, who's a very significant person in our family's life. And when he was 14, he was with his father on Saturday night, and his dad committed suicide on Sunday morning. And he left school eventually. I believe he is probably diagnosed with bipolar, as I think his father was, but it was all underground. Some support from home. He's not homeless. But he's really stuck at 14 or 15. And I'm far away. He's in Syracuse, New York. And I don't know where to begin with service support because he doesn't have a family that knows how to gather that. And I could talk to somebody, one of you, maybe afterward. But I'm here thinking, wow, maybe there's someone that can help me. You know, I just texted him and said, I'm thinking of you. That's what I do, you know. So that's my comment.
Yeah, I was going to say that there's probably a lot of wonderful resources in this room and beyond who can provide amazing suggestions. And, you know, and as well as in, you know, Syracuse, is that where he is in Syracuse? You know, and there's some great supports there as well to connect to. So, but I would definitely look to some people here.
I work in schools where it's like 95% poverty. And so when we use any of the assessment pieces, you know, 80% of our kids are going to fit that, no, unfortunately. So as a result, we talk a lot about not replicating services, which means it's really hard to do the web, which is unfortunate because I think that is what will make the difference. So how do we do that very hard job of allocating resources?
It's actually, I would love to open that question up to everybody here. And it's not my way to punt. I've got my own hard-headed ideas on that. But I think just more productively, it's something that just very honestly, I think nobody has figured out. And so we're actually searching as well on good solutions. And so I'm curious if other people have had experiences or have ideas about how do you actually, one, create a web, number one, but also in this situation where in a context where the vast majority of young people are experiencing severe adversity in their lives. So I'd love to hear.
We have the same opportunity, instead of, I'll say opportunity rather than challenge, in Minneapolis. And we talk a lot about collective impact. And I would say remember that it just takes one caring adult, but as much as all of our nonprofits and schools and government can work together on collective impact and not duplicating and replicating, but working together, we can make a difference.
Are there other thoughts that people might have?
So I think that, you know, as a school district who was just lurking into how do we better connect with our community in general and particularly around mentoring and what does that look like, you know, one of the things that I know that our district, I'm hoping that we'll be able to do is be more forthcoming with our community partners with data so that they actually know what it is that they're trying to move with a student. And that's easier said than done, but that's one thing that, you know, we're looking forward to trying to do. And I would also say that, you know, certainly collective impact, which is scary to a lot of people, but if you can break it down to let them know specifically what that means, people are, I think, concerned about having to do some things differently or giving up funding, and that's not necessarily what that means, but, you know, it's kind of this big, scary sort of buzzword, and now it's going to be harder for me to get dollars, and it can be that way, but we have to be intentional about that. So, you know, but we're in the same boat. We have about 50,000 students, and as I'm thinking about, you know, one, taking the time to actually uncover what those underlying causes are instead of just trying to improve the student's GPA, I think is going to be a huge culture shift for us, a culture shift in asking our teachers, like what Craig was saying in the beginning, just to pay attention. Ask the question. Doesn't mean you have to be the savior or solve it, but at least ask the question and connect the child to someone who can. So, you know, I'm glad to be here and we're learning a lot. It seems daunting, but it's also hopeful at the same time. And I think we just have to start small and make adjustments as necessary. So, for what it's worth.
Hi, I just had a quick question. So you talked a little in the beginning about the different reasons in that, and I was curious if you looked into like Eve Tuck's work on push out and that concept, or were you like knowingly choosing to not go into that realm of school conditions and that? Because you kind of, I mean, you mentioned expulsion, right, which is a huge part of those things, but that was just my just question. Like, was that an intentional choice in this research to really focus on the student perspective versus digging more into some of the structural reasonings behind that?
So, yes on the intentional. Yes on the Eve Tuck, we, you know her work, but and others on the idea of push out. And so, you know, so in our report we do mention, obviously, that exclusionary discipline policy is not going to work. And it's relevant to this particular topic because if what we're seeing is that young people, well, we know from a lot of other research, which is young people who are experiencing severe forms of adversity, may act in ways that don't seem appropriate to people working in a school, that they may seem disruptive, et cetera, and that the process to then resolve that issue is to then get rid of that student, to push them out, right? So exclusionary discipline policy then becomes the wrong hammer for the wrong nail in the wrong wood in the wrong house, everything, right? So it's just the wrong approach. And we'll, you know, we speak out pretty strongly about that to that point. Now, from our perspective on this project, though, we did, just the scope of this particular project was very much focused on the youth perspective. And so we did, young people did tell us and reflect with us on issues in the school structurally, wanted to be true to what they said. This is similar to issues we've dealt with in issues of structural racism, that you don't actually see it very much in either of these two reports. And it's not that we don't recognize it, we very much clearly do, but we wanted to be true to what the young people were telling us. And some young people do talk about it. I mean, it wasn't like it wasn't talked about. but it wasn't, but we didn't then take the approach of then saying to critically analyze what the structures were as part of this particular report. But I will emphasize that those are incredibly important things to recognize, that when we're thinking about how do you better support young people, that there are a lot of structural issues and policy issues which can negatively impact how then schools will treat youth. There's a reality to a teacher. I'm not a high school teacher, but I don't even play one on TV. I was going to go there. But there's a reality I do know from teachers that if you do have disruptive students, for whatever reason that disruption is taking place, it hampers your ability to do your job. And so you kind of kind of get where they're going with, I just want this student out of my classroom. But longer term, it's not going to be good for the student, it's not going to be good for the school, and therefore it's not going to long term be good for the teacher. And that's where groups like Turnaround for Children and groups like them have been so important, because they recognize that to go in and actually do any sort of school-based reform, so any academic reform, you first have to resolve the issues these young people are facing. Because when you go into schools where, as was mentioned, 80%, let's say, of the students are experiencing severe adversity, then what are you going to do? It's not going to be one student disrupting. It's going to be probably a bunch of young people who will seem unruly, right? I mean, they're different code words people can use. But then the hammer being used is not the appropriate one.
You guys mentioned earlier that the source and type of support matters, and that for young people who experience more adversity or greater hurdles in their lives, that they need a ton of support. I work for a mentoring organization that exclusively serves foster care youth, and so our children have GALs and social workers and community support workers. They oftentimes have therapists and tutors, and we're also giving them a mentor. And I see all the time that they and their caregivers are overwhelmed by these service providers and frustrated. How can we maintain a level of quality and effectiveness while also making sure that all of these areas are addressed for them?
Yeah, that's a huge issue. And in foster care is a great example of overall why this can be difficult. One issue, and this is not to, again, I'm not trying to bemoan any sector or any worker in any sector. We're all trying to do our best. But too often you get certain people in certain roles who aren't equipped to be in that role, right? So if we step back for a second and say, well, what does a young person need? So again, take this youth-centered perspective, and you say, well, I need that social worker to provide some services for me, but I need that social worker also to kind of care about me, right? I need that social worker to see me as a person, and to provide emotional support as well as this instrumental support and probably hopefully informational support for me. But that doesn't always happen, right? I mean, there's people in any profession who are like that. And again, there are structural issues that prevent some things, right? So you just don't have enough. So the reality is a lot of social workers or caseworkers are so overwhelmed that to provide that level of intimacy that would actually create that emotional bond, it just isn't possible. So that's why I say I'm not trying to point fingers at any one individual, but I think what you talk about is a complex problem. But if you think about it, so I'll take a less severe form of experience, which is in schools, where the Center for Promise is based out of the Boston University School of Education. So I'm based at a school of education. I have yet to see a school of education that teaches relationships. Right. So is anybody here a teacher, a former teacher? Were any of you in your school of education or training program, if you didn't go through a traditional, taught about how to bond with students? Okay. So that reaffirms everything else I've heard, right? So that's an example, though. Again, go to somebody who's a caseworker. Have you been trained on how to connect with the people you're supporting, right? It's just not there. So as often. And in human services, you'd think that would be number one. Now, again, in things like counseling, social work, they tend to be better about that because it's kind of the part of your practicum experiences. Is it as good as it needs to be? Probably not, right? So there's a huge training gap, I think, going on here, and probably a selection gap, recruitment gap, right? So are the right people being recruited into jobs? Not always. And so I think, you know, what do we do now for the young people you're currently working with to resolve that frustration? That's a really hard question. You know, just because I think that you it's sort of they're within a structure that's really hard to get out of. So again, I would love other people's thoughts. And sorry, I know you.
In addition to having the right people with the right training, I think it's also very important, as the councilman stated in the plenary this morning, throwing everything at this young person at the same time. Get a job, pull your pants up, cut your hair, do this, do that. Da, da. You really have to work on those different things. In some of those can be done at the same time, but others need to be done, you know, finish this one, now let's move on to the next one, let's move on to the next one, versus taking a big pile of this is all you need to do and dump it on top of that individual or that youth, you know, at one time. We can definitely do the map, and then here's how we achieve those milestones and those goals, but trying to throw it all at one time and get help for, you know, your medical issues, your food issues, your educational issues, your social issues, all of these different issues at the exact same time, it's overwhelming for someone who doesn't have, you know, a background of issues, and so, or as severe issues, because I think we all have issues. but I think you understand what I'm saying, but yeah. You can't throw it all at them at the same time.
No, I appreciate you saying that, because a principal back in Boston, near Boston, Malden, Massachusetts, for anybody who knows the Boston area. I named the district just because if you can connect with him as the principal, he's just a wealth of knowledge and expertise. So, because right to your point, so he was dealing with, basically said, my school works for, I think he said, 80% of my students, or it was even 85% if you looked at 5 or 6 year graduation rates. A school of like, you know, 1,500, 2,000, so you're still talking about a couple hundred students every year whose school is not working for. And he said, that's not acceptable. And so they actually restructured their school. And again, he can talk more about how do you do that as a principal, right? That's not an easy task. But exactly to your point, he said, we get a lot of young people who have multiple adversities in their life. What we do to start with them is we tell our faculty and our staff not to focus on education first. And like, well, you know, how would you not focus on, like, your school, right? He's like, because that's not going to be helpful, right to your point. Like, if you start with that goal, you've already failed. So let's start with stripping away piece by piece, and then we can get to the finish line eventually. It's a really great point you make.
Yeah.
Just make a couple of comments. To the young lady, when in this field, I get very overwhelmed by the amount of hurdles these kids have and the complexity that we're dealing with. So I break it down to scale. For me, I can deal with one person, one problem at a time. And that's what I do. That helps me keep doing it day after day and year after year. And because I can only do what I can do within my reach. So I love that. Also, to the lady that spoke about how to reach teenagers, and that some innately do it. And I don't know, maybe there are people who innately can relate. I was not one of those people. When I took on this job in my social services, I was retired military. So relating was not what we were taught to do. But when I took on social services, I learned how to do it. So it can be taught. You can learn how to relate and smile at people and ask them to do things instead of telling them to do things. Because going from a chief to working with volunteers was really hard to do. But I learned it, is my point. It can be learned. And I learned how to speak to teenagers in high school. I didn't know how to do that either, so I learned it. So that's just my encouragement, is that all these skills can be learned if we decide that we want to learn them and just do it one step, one person at a time, one day at a time.
I think one of the things we need to look at as well is sometimes with our systems, our institutions, we require services, and that person does not necessarily need that service or open to that service, but there might be somebody down the road who is open to that service. So we waste a lot of services by the system we've set up.
Yeah, just to sort of you know, put an exclamation on that is that, again, the approach we take in our work, and not just in research but in practice, which is, again, this idea that it's young people at the center. And so if we don't try to understand what they need first, we end up, you know, one, we're doing a whole lot of waste, and also do a lot of if they build it, they will come, and then wondering why they didn't come. Well, it's because they had no relevance to their lives at that point. So actually asking young people what you need, it seems so unique, or seems so obvious, and yet it's so unique.
I just want to share a response to what you said. One kid, one issue at a time. I was just remembering I run a mentoring program, and there was a girl who had multiple issues, abandoned by the mother, living with a teenager. I mean, and the mentor was just overwhelmed by all of this, and, you know, she uncovered one thing that we worked on solving. It was a very small thing. She wanted her to read over the break, and so we figured out how to get her a library card. But what was interesting is that then I did this Thank You Mentor video for Thank You Mentor Day, and what the girl said in her little thank you was, thank you for strengthening me. And I thought of all the things that we think that girl needed, she found in her mentor the strength to live her life.
Any other questions?
You know, I think one last thing I'd like to just throw out there is, I think that what you guys, the report name is really important too, and don't call them dropouts, because I think the narrative is one that to inspire a young person to believe they can be successful when all the factors around them, the physical factors, the way their neighborhood looks, the environment they deal with and the people they deal with show them patterns of unsuccessful behavior. Mm-hmm. So creating a narrative that's empowering, that makes it look cool, that makes it look successful to own your success factors is critical. And I think that messaging is a great start to changing the social service dialogue around young people that aren't achieving what we may think are the standard outcomes for success, because it happens so many different ways. And one of the things that's critical to my outreach to young people is realizing you can't tell somebody that doesn't have a playbook to get to the end zone. You have to help them figure that playbook out, right? And you can't necessarily criticize the things they're doing to get yardage up the field, because everybody's got to move somewhere, right? So they're going to be affected by certain factors. It's like the brother from Richmond said, they want money oftentimes, so they're making moves to get that, right? So we can't be so critical of where they are. So much as creating an inspiring narrative to say, we all believe in you and your potential to achieve.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, in the work that we do, I think that comes across pretty clearly. You know, we believe in you, you know, in young people. And we kind of let go of the reins. I mean, like, you know, this is you've got to learn how to do this. I'm here to support you in this. And just know that I got your back. You know what I mean? Like, little guardrails, you know, to keep you on track.
I just want to make a plug for strength-based work with young people, because for working in special ed for so many years, every year the IEP is based, it's a deficit model every year, and our kids end up at transition without any idea what they were good at. So we used the strength-based finder with the students, and at a whole meeting just based on that where they introduce themselves, instead of adding it to and then having a different meeting about how you're going to use those strengths. Because even when we do their strengths, it's like, okay, you're good at this and this, and then 90% of the meeting is deficit. And it was the first time in most of their lives that an entire meeting was spent on discovering their strengths and what they were good at. So I just want to put a plug in for strengths-based work.
I mentor in a college program, and my mentee is studying to be a social worker, and he took a class last year called Hip Hop Social Work. And so using hip hop as an approach to engaging young people, we think of movies, and I'm going to give a plug for the new Creed Rocky movie where Rocky Balboa is a mentor to Apollo Creed's son. It's a very powerful movie and can open dialogue. So I think there are lots of interesting ways to approach young people, but we have to find the right key.
Absolutely. Oh, one more.
You mentioned, Craig, when you visiting a couple kids, and you mentioned visiting places where there existed a real strong web, that there was a, they had a place to go to school, there was some place where they could live. I'm really curious to know, where do those places exist and how did they get there?
So, one of our partners, Gateway College and Careers in Portland partnered up with another organization. I think the name of it is Inside Out. And then you know, like there's a kind of a network there. There's another place, I think in Arizona, they have the like all of those components together, the Freedom School along with Hermosa something or another, which is the housing part of it, as well as the health, the mental health piece. I know that in Boston, there are a number of organizations that are working, like looking to create this kind of community collaborative initiative. So, you know, they're offering young people jobs, they're offering counseling, there's a SNAP office in the building. There was a school at some point, but I think the school moved on, a KIPP school. So there are pockets around where, you know, organizations are realizing that, you know, like, hey, we can't do this alone. We do this thing really well, but we are not counselors. We are not, you know, the, you know, financial advisors or financial literacy teachers that young people need, or we can't provide housing or whatever it is. Yeah.
I would just, a couple things just to add to that. So one is, you know, as America's Promise, we've always sort of in our DNA has been about these comprehensive community initiatives. You know, if we're about all five promises, that's what we're all about with America's Promise. So all five to all young people, it can't be about any one person, organization, or even sector. So it's always been about, you got to do it together collaboratively. So we would definitely believe deeply in that. Now, what I would also say is that we, you know, one of the great things about not only talking to young people around the country, but you also get then introduced to these pretty exemplar organizations. Now, one issue is that we haven't figured out, and this isn't just endemic to this space, how to go from exemplar to systemic. And so that's, I think, a trick. We actually put out a report about a year ago on re-engagement centers, re-engagement experiences, which you can find online, little plug on that one. But it was based on a lot of the experiences of going to these places. And so what you see is, places like, again, Gateway's an example. People, and these aren't necessarily places we went for these interviews for others, but Homeboy Industries in LA, United Teen Equality Center in Lowell, Massachusetts, Ujamaa for those in Minneapolis. And so you see examples of this all over the country. What we tend to see, so there are two pieces that seem to be really important in this kind of work. One is recognizing you need to have more integrated services. And so you do have, again, there's housing components, there's mental health components, there's just, and they tend not to call it caseworkers because that is just too generic and sterile, but more like life coach kinds of things. They have that, they have medical, you know, human services involved, hopefully connection to education. But that's been documented by a lot of people. Where we see the miss is that when you see that why they're exemplars, because we see a lot of places that have these components that are kind of flat, that have, you know, foster youth who might be just hit by all sides of stuff that seems to be good for them, but it's actually not. It's because of the lack of relationships and the focus on that. So we see across all these organizations is that what screams at you is the fact that the people working there are building incredible bonds with the young people who are coming there. Because the reality is, especially with the population we're talking about, so this is, we're talking about, you've already gone way downstream. Like, you were upstream a while ago, like, you're way downstream. And so it's really about the reconnection for a lot of the young people. And you have functions like at Homeboy or at UTEC in Lowell, where they have people who, their job is to be in the street working with young people to bring them back, right? They cultivate relationships for up to 2 years. to create the trust to then bring them back in. I'd say that that's such a big part of it. The Yo Centers in Baltimore, which you'll be hearing about later today, do this as well. You know, so I just say you can see the pockets. Check out this report. You know, it's something that we continue to be excited about because we do see people doing great work. The question is, how do you go from exemplar to replication or systemic?
As long as we still have time, why not? I just wanted to mention something that I think needs to be changed in our very near future, and that is the whole suspension policy in our schools. It seems to me that a lot of the kids that are being suspended because of what's happening in their home life that they're bringing into their classrooms. And then we turn around and we suspend them and send them back to their home life. And it just is so ridiculous to me, because the last place they need to be is there. Probably for some of them, the only safe haven they have in their life is when they are at school. So I just feel like maybe there's a way that we have, I understand the need to protect the rest of the children at school from someone who's acting out. But I also think there should be some place on our school's campuses. So instead of people like you just mentioned in Homeboy having to go onto the streets to help these kids who are suspended, why don't they come onto our campuses to help them when they need it so that we can have something that really is a counseling time for them while they're on suspension, where there are people that are really having those group sessions with them and talking to them and understanding them and hearing them out and finding out what's happened to you instead of what's wrong with you. And maybe that will lead to some better services, getting them the services they actually need, instead of sending them home where there isn't anything great happening when we do that for them. So
And I think, you know, one thing that we're starting to see is some interesting models. So, you know, for those who work in schools know that the idea of the school counselor almost becomes laughable in some schools, unfortunately, because you have one counselor to maybe 2,000 students. And so to actually be able to counsel is very difficult. However, we see programs like in Portland, Oregon, self-enhancement, which is a phenomenal, like if you don't know about self-enhancement, know about self-enhancement. Amazing work where they embed people in the schools, multiple people in the schools, who then have, I hate to use the term caseload because that's not how they see them, but they basically work with a group, each works with a group of young people at different levels of risk to make sure that any issue they're dealing with is being resolved and that the goals they have are being pursued. In Orlando, Florida, in the Paramore neighborhood, there's the Paramore Kids Zone, which is one of these CCIs, Comprehensive Community Efforts, where they had a similar function in this few of the high schools there. They're now in a pilot to take actually that throughout the entire city of Orlando based on the effect they've had in Paramore. So again, I think you're starting to see this movement toward how do you get more adults? So City Year is another example, right? They're trying to bring more City Year core members who can integrate them, embed themselves within the schools so they can provide some more support. I think it'll be interesting to see. We're still learning on how do you do this, but this point is where what message does it send to a young person to say, well, we really want you engaged, and there's a whole lot of adults in the room here who we hope could provide support for you, but we're gonna kick you out. So where there's potential for support, we're gonna actually remove you from that situation. That's probably not the best approach. So how do you actually infuse a school with the support so they can actually provide that kind of care that's needed?
Hi. So I run a Big Brothers Big Sisters program in Phoenix. I'm trying to think of what you were talking about with the school there, but so our mayor actually just accepted the My Brother's Keeper initiative in Phoenix, and what was really kind of cool about that whole process was I think what we all have to kind of look at, and it's hard because we're all working in our little bubbles, mm-hmm. and we're all just so focused inward and trying to do our thing that we don't look outwards, and we want to collaborate, but we don't know how to collaborate, so putting this group of folks in this room to help with the My Brother's Keeper initiative, just like this conference, putting all these folks at a conference that do all sorts of different mentoring and figuring out how to collaborate. And so what I even did is we serve 1,600 kids. But we put that social piece in their life. So we have the mentor, but the mentor can't solve a lot of the other issues. So I created a navigator position. So for instance, I have a little sister that's a great little, she's amazing. But she's dealing with a lot of issues that I might not be able to help her with, and to maybe help her, I also maybe have to work with her family. And so we, while we don't do that work at Big Brothers Big Sisters, we know who does that work. So we kind of create the hub and then push them out to other organizations that we collaborate with, because we're all kind of serving the same population. So
it's a great model.
Awesome. I'll just keep talking.
So it looks like we're kind of approaching the end time here. So if there are no further questions or comments, I think we're going to kind of wrap it up here, and we'll be around afterwards if people want to connect on an individual level. Sorry for the people on the web, but but you can go to the website at gradnation.org and get information on how to contact us that way as well. So thank you all for your time, energy, and life force, and we'll see you out there. Yeah.